Yes. In the 90s. And since then has been back periodically. He's taught as a visiting faculty on several different occasions here in the early 2000s. He is involved in an enormous number of different projects, which he's going to tell you something about, but not all of them. If you look at his curriculum vitae, you see he's part of between 6 and 8 different collaborations in Europe, that range a whole range of topics in physics. But the second introduction is that he has got a very different persona as well. He is known for his work in Europe, probably in outreach programs in Germany and Switzerland and Austria, where he is, gives a series of, he gives lectures and demonstrations, I should say, of, and we can, why don't you rip from that? I have some few graphs of Christian in his acting role on in demonstrations before. He started out with lower school, moved on to high school. He now lectures to universities. He lectures to business groups. He lectures to has lectured at CERN, giving these demonstrations with his colleague Angela. This is a picture of the audience of a Christmas show he gives annually in Heidelberg. It seats 500. There are 5,000 asked to get tickets, and the audience cannot fit into the room. As he's talking about coming to the United States on a grand tour, sometime perhaps in a couple of years. It's a traveling show. It takes many people to set up a truck to carry his equipment on him. That's a picture of the cast of support cast.
Yeah.
So you get some size of the scale of the operation. It's a marvelous presentation. But he's going to talk to us today about some of the physics.
Yeah. Thank you, George. It's a great pleasure to be here to see all or so many familiar faces. I have to disappoint you at the beginning because I'm not doing any of those demonstrations here today. I will talk about something which started actually here at Brown. A few meters from here. Basically, the story I want to tell you is what happens afterwards. It's 25 years ago. And 25 years ago, there was the low temperature lab, which still exists. But these people were in the low temperature lab, and they were working on a low temperature detector for solar neutrinos, the HIRON project. This was guided by Humphrey Maris, by Bob Lanou, and George Seidel. And there were 3 graduate students with me at the time. And at some day, I believe this was early 1993, George came into the lab and said, I had a paper to review, and they got it all wrong. I think I know how one could do that. And I'm not going into details now, but Simon and myself were standing there, and he said, if you get it right, you go through the roof. I still see that in front of me, and given his nature, this was a very enthusiastic enthusiastic call, I would say. We thought about it, and we did some initial tests, and one more picture here. This was the more wider low temperature group. You see Humphrey here and George, and there were other projects. And Bob is missing here because he was at a sabbatical at Berkeley. He wouldn't have counted at low temperature group either. Yeah, you were in Berkeley. So, yes. Yes, Gerson Goldhaber. So, the summer after that, there was a paper on that. And what was called at that time a metallic magnetic bolometer. This was basically outlining what the idea was. And I will tell you that in a minute. And then after this group of people, other people came, like Yong Ham Kim. He was a graduate student. Andreas Fleischmann was here for a year and worked with George on those topics. And one last picture. This is a couple of years later. In 1995, I obtained a small grant and could start working on this concept. George was a frequent visitor and was really a happy time. I mean, we visited back and forth often, and we made a lot of progress, I think, and we investigated the basic science of that, or the basic material science of that. That all led to a long review in 2005. 2005, basically, the initial phase was over. We understood the material science. And then something else needed to be done. We needed to make those in the clean room. I mean, we needed to develop those processes. And in addition, something else happened. Simon Bandler in the US started an effort, and also Yong Ham in South Korea. So it was not only us anymore. It spread it out. So what I'm talking about is a microcalorimeter. And now let me come more to the physics here. That's a simple device. You have an absorber which is suited for the particle to detect. And this is thermally coupled to a bath. And what you do, you monitor the energy content with a sensitive thermometer. And if a particle hits, this energy content changes, the temperature changes, and you measure that with this thermometer. So there are different concepts out. The well-known TES, transition age sensors, and these are excellent detectors, and this is a well-developed technology widely used in the US and other places. Then semiconductor thermistors, these are a little older techniques, they're still in use. It has this slight disadvantage because it's a high impedance device and it's hard to multiplex. And then these are the magnetic calorimeters or metallic magnetic calorimeters, which we are working on. And I will concentrate on that lower part here. Now, how does an event look like? A typical event that would be an X-ray, for example, 6 keV. The calorimeter is at bath temperature, and then the X-ray hits, and the temperature rises. Typically, at an operational temperature of 30 millikelvin by about 1 millikelvin. It's given simply by the energy divided by the total heat capacity. And then it relaxes back to the bath. And this relaxation back you can determine by how strong you make the link. And this is basically given here by the thermal conductance. Now, in case, now what can you do with such a system? Well, the point is, since you have a thermal detector and the absorber you can more or less freely choose, you can do a lot of different things. It depends on the design of your system. And that summarizes what people have done worldwide with those microcalorimeters. So this electromagnetic spectrum, obviously. And this gray region here is a region where you have single photon resolution with some kind of thermal detectors. So you're in the X-ray, gamma ray, but also optical. You have single photon resolution. But those detectors have also been used, or this detection technique, where you have a flux of photons. You measure basically the constant flux. And of course, you can detect particles with it, alpha, beta particles, neutrinos, or you can do neutrino physics with it. And you can also do things which we don't know they exist, or we don't know what it is. You can look for dark matter and other things. So they are sort of universal. Yeah? And they live from the fact that they are very sensitive to small energy impacts. Now, the concept we were following was the one George was at that point realizing would be a good way to go. this is basically a paramagnetic system where you rely on the change of magnetization. In our case, for example, gold doped with erbium or silver doped with erbium. And the system would be such, you would have a sensor made out of this paramagnetic material, and you would pick up the change of magnetization by the change of flux produced in the superconducting loop. And this would form a flux transformer with a squid, and you would measure the size of this change here. So the thing is operated in a small magnetic field, of course. Now, so this change in temperature translates in a change of magnetization. Compared to those resistive thermometers, the TESS and also the semiconductor thermistors, there is two differences. One is no dissipation in the sensor. There is no current passed through. And the second thing is you have no galvanic contact. This gives you some freedom in the design. Now, those thermal detectors, principally, will have the same resolution if everything is optimal. Because this is basically given by the Nyquist noise, by the noise of the flux, the phonon flux, the phonon going up and down, fluctuating between the bars and the calorimeter, and the bandwidth of your measurement. And that's true for all of those detectors. What you have to realize is that your readout electronics has to be at least as good or better than this noise. If you have not a good readout electronics, you can spoil this resolution. But in principle, it's possible to reach this here. Yeah. Yeah. I should have said this. Tau naught is the rise time, and this is the fall time of the signal, tau naught. So this basically is the Fourier, is the Fourier spectrum or the bandwidth of the detector information. That's what the detector sees.
And so kind of in a Nyquist noise thing, that's like where the
this is the white noise. No. No, these are phonons. These are phonons and electrons going back and forth, depending on how you design the device.
So the thermal link controls tau 1?
No, yes, tau 1 is controlled by the thermal link, that's correct. And tau 0 is controlled by how fast the sensor can sense the energy change in the absorber. Yeah? And that basically is the bandwidth I'm talking about. And that in some realizations, I mean, how you write this down, can be different for different detectors, but at the end it's the same. You have a white noise, and that basically is the bandwidth over which you look. Yeah? Now, the way you realize that in the early days when we looked at the material parameters, we were doing hand-wound coils around a piece of metal, these kind of things. But at some point, one has to make that a little bit more professional is maybe not the right word, but in a way you can make many, many of those in a fabrication process. So you need a planar realization of that. And the planar realization is you have this meandering superconducting coil, and this is a gradiometric coil, so you make two pixels which you read out with one squid. So you freeze in a current into this meandering coil, and when a particle comes, heats up your paramagnetic sensor, it changes the flux in this superconducting loop, and the flux change is picked up by the squid. So in the flux transformer, the flux is constant, and therefore the flux has also to change in the squid. Here's a picture of how such a detector looks like. Here, no sensor, no absorber is processed on top of it. Here, there is a fully functioning detector. Now, these stems here in between, these are necessary to ensure that you have a full thermalization within the absorber. The absorber consists of gold, and you might have R-thermal phonons, for example, escaping directly to the sensor and also the substrate. You don't want that. You want to thermalize that, and then it goes to the sensor. This is the idea behind that. Now, In Heidelberg, we have 2006 started to set up a clean room. There was an empty clean room at the time. And we sort of step by step, we bought the utilities we needed. And now these are some of the examples of structures we're doing there now. We're doing our own squids and amplifier squids. So over the course of 10 years, we needed to learn a lot of those processes. Meanwhile, these are rather complicated devices. The most complicated one had 18 lithographic layers. I mean, this is really something not trivial with many different materials, gold erbium, aluminum, and so on, many different kinds. Now, we read those systems out with a squid. I was mentioning that before, but normally we use a double stage squid setup for the following reason. If we would pass a large bias current through this first, the squid, which sits at the same temperature than the detector, it would warm up the system. So we pass a relatively small bias current through it, and we have an amplification chain with then at 1 Kelvin, we have another squid or a series array squid to provide a low dissipation readout channel for that kind of system. And then it's room temperature electronics. What you have to make sure is that your signal size is large enough that the semiconductor amplifier is not impeding the noise on it. Yeah? So the specs of that is good enough to keep the noise you had before. Now, this is a result. This is, in fact, the best result we realized with one of the detectors. This is exactly this kind of scheme here. This was an absorber, 250 micrometer by 250 micrometer, 5 micrometer thick. So you have for X-ray photons, 6 kV, you have a quantum efficiency of 98%, and that here is the K-alpha line of manganese 55, and you see here nicely the fine splitting. Yeah? That has the resolution of that detector was 1.58 eV, and this is exactly, by coincidence, exactly the same result than with test detectors, and we share basically the record for those detectors. So this is, for all energy dispersive detectors, this is really the best result. Yeah? Now, this was not after processing the data for a long time. This is the online picture. That's how it came out of the cryostat here. So it's not like you have to throw away 99% of the counts to end up with a spectrum. That's not the case. This is really the same spectrum here. Now, you can use the same detector also for wider bandwidths. Yeah?
How big is the magnetic field?
The magnetic field, in this case, we were running in this meander a current of 100 milliamps. Yeah? There was not a static magnetic field applied. No. This meander has the advantage that you have a constant magnetic field over a certain wide range, but you have a multiple of high order. So crosstalk between those different pixels is much less, and this is also an ideal suited geometry for microfabrication. I mean, this principal picture I was showing, where the wire is around the cylinder, this we did at the beginning with handmade detectors. But later on, we were using always this scheme here. Yeah?
Okay, so there's a local excitation of magnetic moment?
Yeah, there's in the film, in this gold erbium film, there you have magnetic field lines produced by the current in the meander. And it's not a homogeneous field. And that's for good reason not a homogeneous field, because you would otherwise have in neighboring pixels some changes as well. From the erbium, in this case, 300 ppm. Yeah. Okay, so that was this is a nice result. And then you can use the same kind of detector over wider bandwidths. This is an americium source, decays by alpha to neptunium. And the neptunium is in the excited state and de-excites via X-ray photons and also gammas, which you see here. And the X-ray photons which come out are lifetime broadened. So the width here is not given by the detector instrumentation. It's given by the lifetime. And you can see this nicely here if you compare that to the nuclear transition. This is limited by the detector resolution. Now, to summarize the performance of such a detector, I'm just putting up this here. I talked about the resolution, and this is really a crucial piece, of course, but there are some other aspects, and this is something which is important in many applications. You have a fast rise time. In terms of gold erbium, this is given by the Coringa constant, and at those temperatures, the rise time you have below 100 nanoseconds, let's say. In this case, about 80 nanoseconds. And then you can look at the linearity. This device I was showing has a linearity, or is a very good linearity. It's off by 1% at the higher energies here. Yeah? And that is for such a thermal detector, which is really optimized to have really very good energy resolution, a very good result. Now, what are the projects? George was referring to that. Since the detectors are working so well, we have been starting too many things. But they are in those areas here. I mean, atomic and molecular physics, radiation quantum metrology, nuclear physics, neutrino mass experiments, and lately also in dark matter. So you see all the project names here, and you need very different designs. The simple X-ray detector I was showing you, this is only one version of the detectors we are using at the moment. There's another way. I will show you two examples in more detail. This is the recombination of molecular ions, the physics which is done with that. And the second thing is the electron capture holmium experiment, which is a neutrino mass measurement. Now you can see this, look at this also in a different way. These are the places in the world people either develop or use metallic calorimeters. And I like this picture here. You could say in Asia, Yong Ham is leading the effort. In US, Simon Bandler is leading the effort. And in Heidelberg, Andreas Fleischmann. And therefore, they came all from Brown. So this spread over the world now. Good. Let me start with the first application. This is in the atomic and molecular physics experiments. Detection of molecular fragments, and Andreas is doing that mainly. So the question here is the following, or the motivation for that work. You find in interstellar clouds certain molecules and molecular ions in a distribution you don't understand if you repeat experiments on Earth when you try to create or break them up, and those rates you measure are off by orders of magnitude. So this is known. This has been known in the 90s, and these three people, Dirk Schwalm, Andreas Wolf, and Daniel Seifmann, they had the idea that this might have to do with the fact that it's cold out in space, so that these molecules are in the rotational ground state, and the chemistry may depend on that. I mean, that's a far-reaching speculation in some sense. But it led to the design of such a storage ring here for ions, an electrostatic storage ring, which can be cooled, or which is cooled to 10 Kelvin. So the ions are stored here, the molecular ions, and slowly go into the rotational ground state. And then recombination with electrons happens here. And they break up. Here it's an example, H3 plus an electron, and you get two neutral fragments. And those neutral fragments need to be detected. And for that, our detector will be used. Now, to give you an impression of the ring, this was finished 1.5 years ago. That's how this electrostatic storage ring looks like. And how do we detect that? Well, you have this molecule ABCD plus an electron, and it breaks apart. and different options in which fragments it breaks apart. But then you assume that the fragmentation, after the fragmentation, all the fragments have still the beam energy. And if they then are stopped in the detector and you measure the kinetic energy, you can infer the mass. That's basically the idea behind that experiment. Now, what you want from such a detector, that's the list we were given from the Max Planck Institute. You want energy resolution, large detection area to look at wider angles, counting efficiency, multi-head capability, position resolution, and time resolution. We can fulfill everything except time resolution. But for that, with our detectors and a second detector attached, one can realize this as well. But this is not, our detectors are not fast enough to do this directly. Yeah? Now, we did some test experiments at the Max Planck Institute using a plasma source there. So molecular ions, or at the beginning, very simple things like protons, were produced and then accelerated and selected here, mass selected, and then were pointing to our detectors in the cryostat. Problem in this experiment was, of course, this is room temperature here, and we had to be at 20 millikelvin with the detector, so we couldn't allow only a very small hole or several small holes where we fed these ions through. Here you see a detector array. This was not produced for this experiment. This was just something we had. This is a detector array we made for gamma ray experiments at the GSI. Now, that's how the detector looks like. Here are two blocks, each 8 pixels. And they are different in color, and they're different in color because one is made out of gold, and the other one is coated with aluminum, the gold. To see what the effect is in terms of the impact of the massive objects. So, and then this had to be designed such that you can keep the detectors cold. I was talking about that. Now, this was sort of the first experimental result. We moved the cryostat up, but 2 days later we saw this nice signal. There were protons. We didn't know it would work at all at the time, but it did. The detector was cold, and we could do this, and it had a width of 400 eV. Then we started to investigate the width as a function of the energy to which it was accelerated. You can see, of course, the width changes because you have a massive object impacting in your absorber. You create some damage, and that, of course, will widen your curves. Yeah? Now, this can be understood. You can, if you have a molecule, molecular fragment, which goes into your detector here, then it can either, pieces of it can be backscattered. Other processes would be that some of the gold atoms or whatever the absorber is are sputtered. And also you can create lattice defects. So interstitials, Franklin pairs, for example. So that really creates energy losses, and therefore it degrades the performance of the detector. We needed to study that to know whether we are on the right track and can do these experiments there. Now, if you do a calculation, and this was a measurement later with CH3+, you can simulate that, the Monte Carlo simulation, which is suited for lower energy processes. Then you can separate the lattice defects, this is the blue thing, and then the total here, backscattering, is the major effect here together with the lattice defect. Now, after understanding that, it was clear it's better to have a lighter absorber rather than gold, because then the molecular ion would go deeper inside and would have less chance to backscatter fragments of it. So we tested that, and that in fact worked, so they don't have these big blobs. I show you in a second. Now, then we did an experiment where this CH3+ was accelerated, and on the way, some of those caught an electron, and we were deflecting all the others which are still charged, and we're only looking at the ones which caught an electron, and this is exactly, basically, this what we wanted to do later in the storage ring, and you nicely can see all the fragments. Yeah? That's what they look for there. I mean, they want the reaction rates, which are the amplitudes, basically, of the fragments. They want the angles and so on. That's basically the detector which is foreseen for that. So what we are developing right now, what we are doing in the clean room, is the following. We are making this 4-pixel molecular camera. It has 4,096 pixels, and it has positional capability. You can see Andreas Fleischmann here with 4,000 K. It's not so bad. You can really measure something from that. The interesting aspect of that detector is it's read out by only 32 squids. So you need to do some tricks to do that, and I will show you which. So because energy resolution, which was needed there to identify these peaks, is about 10%. That's what you need. So the single pixel detectors are much more sensitive. This is not needed. And therefore, we made rows and columns of these meandering coils, and we are having in series many of those sensors. Yeah? And then you can say, okay, if two squids, for one here and one here, is firing, it has to be one of those four sensors. Now, since those are gradimetric coils, you can look at the polarity here. If this polarity here is positive, then it can only be those two. If we then look at this squid at the polarity, and it's, for example, going down, then you can identify where it has happened. Yeah? In addition, we are using a principle, which is the Hydra principle. I will go to that in a minute. You see here some details. This is, for example, a close-up of a produced detector, the absorbers here. This is here one of the meanders. We ripped off the absorbers to see what is underneath, to see how the production process works and so on. We made some progress on that, as you can see. Now, the Hydra principle is basically you have to each sensor several absorbers attached. And you, by intention, have different thermal couplings to this absorber. This was actually pioneered by the NASA group. And see, here you can see a calculation for four absorbers. And so the weakest coupling is this one, and the fastest is this one here. And you can distinguish then in which pixel this has happened, even if the same sensor was firing. Yeah? Now we just completed a small version of the MOCA detector. You can see it here in the cryostat. We measured the crosstalk between pixels. This is only 0.05%, which is nice. This is read out by 8 squids and has 256 pixels. And this is a first test of these different families. Pulse families from the Hydra, and you can see you can nicely identify these four families. Yeah? So this is the first step towards the real realization of such a detector. And we are working on different things. I mean, we are doing absorber tests here, and this would be the thing it's mounted on later on. This is a production of a quarter of a real MOCA detector, so we will test that at some point. So that's something, there's a lot of clean room work needed to perfection all those processes that you actually have a functioning detector at the end with 4,000 pixels. Now, let me turn to the neutrino experiments, and that's headed by Loredana Gastaldo, this effort. The idea here is the direct determination of the neutrino mass. So we don't know this, the neutrino mass. The best current limits are for the electron antineutrino 2 eV from the Troisk-Mainz experiments. They use the tritium decay. The best limit for the electron neutrino is 225, and that's from the electron capture in holmium. So we want to use this principle. Holmium decays via electron capture event to dysprosium, and the dysprosium is in the excited state, and the neutrino leaves the system. Now, if you measure all the energy which comes out while this dysprosium goes back to the ground state, then you can measure the spectrum here from the different capture lines, and at the end point, you see that the neutrino also takes away some energy, even if it has only rest energy. I will show you this more detailed here. So the spectrum is given by this formula. This is a sum over the Bragg-Wiener resonances from the different capture levels. And then you have the phase space factor here, where the maximal transitional energy, the Q value, enters. And when the energy we measure in the decay comes close to that value here, then the neutrino mass has a significant impact on the phase factor. Yeah? So that's again the spectrum here. And if you look then at the end point compared to mass zero, you modify the decay here, the form of the curve here. Now, this is shown here for 2 eV and 5 eV. Yeah? At the end, of course, you will measure only one of those lines. You cannot compare. So you have to theoretically analyze that also very well. And why is holmium used? Holmium has the lowest Q value in nature, known for electron capture experiments. It was not very well known until recently. So Penning trap measurements were done. And we also did this with our microcalorimeters, and that agree very well. And the wrong value in the particle data book was corrected to this value now. Okay, how we do this? We embed the holmium into a gold absorber, and then the rest is the same kind of measurement than we did with the fragments and also with the X-ray. So it decays by X-ray and Auger electrons, and we just have to measure the energy which is released into the absorber. Now, the first, very first experiment, and that's really some ways remarkable. I told you we started to fill the clean room 2006. This was one of the first detectors which came out with 4 pixels, very primitive at this point. And Loredana took it to CERN, and it was implanted via a spallation source. And nobody knew whether the thing would survive or what would happen. And what definitely happened at the beginning, it was radioactively hot. So we had to let it cool off for a couple of years. And nobody knew whether we would see anything. Yeah? But to our surprise, 2012, it was measured. And we saw a nice holmium spectrum. There were still some other radioactive material in there, although mass selection was used at the time. But this was the first really high-resolution spectrum of holmium. You can see older attempts with other detectors here. Now, the same detector lives on, and this is a spectrum after, well, the resolution is not very well on the screen here. But it still lives on. The praseodymium, this has decayed because it has a shorter lifetime. And you see nicely those peaks. Now, meanwhile, a large collaboration has been formed. You don't want to produce this by a spallation source. This is now by irradiation of erbium in a reactor and chemical processing after that. You need people who calculate the background and so on. So many different groups are involved now in this effort. We got funding from the DFG in Germany, and we are starting this effort to measure the neutrino mass. I give you a few other points on this. This again is the spectrum, and this is the fraction of events in the interval next to the endpoint. So 20 eV away, you have still that much events. But then if you only one in the last 1 eV, you have about that fraction of events. So you need very, very high statistics to do this. Yeah, you will have no counts otherwise. You need?
Yeah.
I will tell you in a second. We will have a phased approach where we have 100 at the beginning and then 10,000 and so on. So that is a large effort. I show you in a minute. Now, one problem here is you could say, okay, let's increase the activity per pixel so you get many counts in one detector. The problem here is you measure the full spectrum always and you get the convolution with itself as pile up. That is basically the red curve here. This is the pile up spectrum. So it cuts off at some point the sensitivity at the endpoint. Therefore, one can calculate what is the pile up fraction you can tolerate to measure the neutrino mass better than 1 eV. And therefore, this pile up fraction has to be adjusted by the pixel activity and the rise time of our detector. So the rise time, I told you, is the Coringa process is fixing that. We can, this is not a knob we can turn. Luckily, the magnetic calorimeters are the fastest microcalorimeters. That gives us some headroom, but then we still have to adjust the activity here. Now, and you, this was here only an example to show whether you can, with a slow rise time, you cannot identify those pileups. That's the reason why you need a fast rise time. Now, this would be an example for calculation with a pileup fraction of 6, 10 to minus 6, and then if the neutrino mass is 2, you had to distinguish these two curves. That's how big the problem is or how complicated it is. Now, we investigated also, or there's an ongoing effort to investigate the background. The background, of course, the external background has to be at least as good as the internal one. Yeah? And so what we are aiming for is something like that, 5 times 10 to the minus 5 counts per EV per detector per day. This might not mean much at the moment. We did an experiment at the Modan mine, where we bought the cryostat you have seen now before to this underground lab and did some measurements. We did another measurement of the holmium spectrum, this time with a purified source, so there were no other peaks than the ones expected. And we looked outside that window how many counts we would have. And from that, we can make at least a crude estimate that this detector, which was not treated in any way before, and it was a relatively bulky detector, we had 10 to the minus 4 events per EV per day per detector, so it's not far off, and we didn't use any other means of discrimination or something like that at the moment. Now, yeah, okay, that's the gray is the measurement, the purple is one theory, and the blue one is another theory. There's a theoretical effort because you have high order, if you have a very sensitive measurement of such a spectrum, you see also high order effects, where you create two holes or even three holes. And there is a lot of debate how this will look like. That definitely has to be settled to be able to infer a neutrino mass from that kind of thing, but this is still an ongoing theoretical effort. And our experiments, which will be much more precise than that one in the near future, will pin down in which direction it goes. I mean, we'll see all those additional small peaks, and we will learn a lot of those from those spectrum. Yeah? Now, what is our plan at the moment? This is a calculation of the sensitivity, statistical sensitivity, and this is the total number of events. So in the first phase, which already is commissioned at the moment, we will have 100 pixels with 10 becquerel. We will measure 4 months and hope to be better than 10 eV, which would be improvement of 20, factor of 20 of the value we have at the moment. And then the next much more challenging step is using 50 chips with about 200 pixel and 10 becquerel and measure 3 years, then we would reduce the resolution to something less of 2 eV. But we have to see what is the outcome of the first step to even make a good extrapolation. This is from the present knowledge, I would say. Now, this is the detector chip we have to develop. We have developed it has 64 pixels. We use only 50 to be implanted at the Risiko facility in Mainz. And we have already 4 of them implanted. The rest of the pixels are used in situ background detection and also on-chip thermometry. So 4 of them are implanted. We are at the moment mounting them. The whole experiment is commissioned. We have a new cryostat for there. A lot of wiring is going in. Actually, this here has 2 possibilities to be read out. Can be directly read out with a DC squid, or you can do multiplexing. I will show you this in a minute. So the concept of those detectors will not change. The problem here is Echo 1K, 50 or 100 detectors, depending on how much we use in the first trial, will be read out by the way I showed you, but it will have a lot of wires, because even 100 detectors, if you count all the number of wires, is a large number, and there's no way to scale this up. So to scale this up, you have to develop something else. If you have then more detectors, 5,000 detectors with Echo 100K. Actually, this 1K means 1 kilobecquerel activity, and 100K is 100 kilobecquerel activity, just to make this clear. So you have different choices, and our choice was frequency domain multiplexing, and that's the readout technology we developed for Echo at the moment. So Sebastian Kempf is doing that mainly, and the principle is the following. You have your information in the pulses in a certain band of frequency band, kilohertz to megahertz, and then you modulate this information onto a carrier and onto several carriers, which are spaced narrowly, and they're on the gigahertz range, and therefore you can amplify all of them at once. Yeah? So you don't have to use for each of the detectors their own wiring. Now, the way you really do that is the following. You have the detectors here. This is a schematic of the detectors, 2 of the meanders and then a coil. Then you have an RF squid as nonlinear element. This is the coupling element to an address line, which is a microwave resonator. So this is a resonator operated at 6 gigahertz roughly, or at 5 gigahertz, depending on what address it is. An event here will change the inductance of that RF squid, and via the Muschel inductance, it will change the frequency of that resonator. These resonators are coupled to ground, so you have a transmission, transmission line here, which is then going to ground. Whenever the frequency changes here, you pick up signal, and you get a larger signal in one of those at one of those frequencies. So what you do is you send down a comp of frequencies, and then you analyze later on the amplified signal at room temperatures. What this means, you transform all the complications from low temperatures into a room temperature system, which you have to de-entangle all that later on in a room temperature system. Now, we have produced such a multiplexer with detectors. This is one of the most complicated superconducting electronic pieces. This had 18 layers and many different materials. You can see here the detectors. These are the RF squids. These are the micro resonators. They are differently long. You can see that. So they have different frequencies. Here's some close-ups of that. And this was the first generation, basically. And we measured a spectrum at 6 kV. This is the iron 55, or the manganese 55 line. It has 19 eV. This is the K-alpha line again. So it's not as good as our single pixel result yet, but this was the first generation. We need to have a better micro resonator. The internal Q was not good. And we had some couplings were not optimized between the squid and the micro resonator. The frequency shift was simply too small. Yeah? But now we have made a new device. We have a different coupling to the feed line. We have also a different RF squid, so that coupling to the detector is better. This is the new chip. We are not using, we didn't put the detectors onto that chip. We will just bond that to the echo chip then. So there's also the, it's not so critical whether the microfabrication yields every time. So it's less complex to make. And these have really nice, equally spaced transmission curves here. And we have the expected large frequency shift here. So this is a result which is like 2 weeks ago. And I, while I'm speaking here, I hope they will expose it or they will bond it to a detector and then measure a spectrum. And we will see whether we are closer to the energy resolution. The model, the calculated design, will do it. But whether you can come close enough in reality, we will see. But I am very hopeful for that. What is needed for that is also room temperature electronics, which is quite complex, a software-defined radio. To preserve the fast rise time, we couldn't use any commercially available software-defined radio, so we hooked up with a group in Karlsruhe, and they developed a system of that kind for us. So it's an FPGA, which makes a frequency comp, and this is then modulated onto onto our carrier frequency, and then goes to the cryostat. It comes out, gets demodulated, and then analyzed. That's a lot of work still to do all the programming, but the initial tests have been successful, and we will hopefully have that for many, many channels ready soon. Now, we in fact have not only teamed up with them in terms of the electronics and system integration. That's a group which mainly works on high energy physics and does system integration for some of the detectors at CERN. Over the course of about 2 or 3 years, it was in discussion that they will also have a production site then in Karlsruhe in the Helmholtz Institute. And this now has been approved. This will be built, and we will have an MMC production site there and as well the system integration. So we will in Heidelberg remain a small R&D facility trying to develop new types of detectors and so on. But I hope the larger amount of that production will be done in Karlsruhe. And I think that's a relatively bright future for this technology George invented at the time. And nobody knew it would go that far. Also, he said we would go through the roof. So I don't know what it meant. So let me summarize. I showed you the some properties of those magnetic calorimeters. They are flexible low temperature detectors described by standard thermodynamics. They have a wide range, very wide range of applications. We have some ideas how to optimize even the single pixel devices at the moment. So we will have resolving powers larger than 10,000. For example, we are building right now a squid, which is itself the mander, which picks up the signal. So we pass a current of 100 milliamps through the squid, the meandering squid, and we have first successful tests we have done. So there's a coupling factor, which reduces the signal, is less, and we are quite sure we will get down the energy resolution further. Yeah, I showed you two of those applications. As I said, we do too many things. Even with a large number of graduate students, it becomes very complicated to fulfill all those needs. So we need other people to come in. And I showed you also that worldwide there's other efforts now to build magnetic calorimeters. And we have actually we had routinely telephone conferences between those sites to inform each other to make progress. And this is really a nice way to move forward. Now, that is a list of students which were involved and are involved. This is the three people I was mentioning. They are heading the whole development. These are collaboration partners, and we get money from different sources, obviously. And that's the group in Heidelberg some time ago. And they're still happy, despite all the clean room work. And with that, I'm at the end, and thank you very much. I mean, funny enough, George was asking me exactly that question last night when I came. Do you still look for other materials or have some ideas there? We haven't done that very intensively in the last years when we were developing the microfabrication for those materials, because you have to make those things also, and it's not so not so easy. You have to make a sputter target out of gold doped with erbium, and the erbium has to be isotopically pure. I didn't show you all the details we know already about this material. We worked on that for about 8 years to understand all those material details. So it would not be an easy jump just to different material. And the other answer of that is we don't know anything which would be much better. We couldn't think of like semi-metals, which has less electrons, so you have a lower heat capacity. You could think of something like you have a semiconductor or something like that. But this is a huge materials effort to find everything out and then make it usable in the clean room. Yeah? I'm not ruling it out, but I think that is already a very well thought of material. George was working on it as with ESR experiments before he came up with this idea, so he knew already some of the really necessary important properties. For example, the interaction of the spins is less, the RKK-Bay interaction, than for other for many other systems of this lanthanides. Yeah, and other, and it has a large spin. So there, but this is a long story. I mean, why we optimize this material.
What is it that ultimately limits the application of these calorimeters to room temperature things that one might want to measure? Is it the heat load that the fridge needs to deal with?
Well, it wouldn't be cold at the chip. I mean, we did this experiment at the Max Planck Institute, and we had a 4 micrometer hole where we pointed through those molecules. So that from the infrared photons, the chip wouldn't warm up. But there are limits on that. You can have, if you have photons, then you can have screens. You know, I mean, you can have a window, X-ray window. Then you can do room temperature stuff if you want. But if you have to see the detector directly, so then it becomes complicated.
Could you imagine looking at charged particles? By having them sort of snake through magnetic fields through a path that has no line of sight?
Yeah, so could you hook it to a mass spectrometer? Are projects of this kind we're discussing at the moment. There are possibilities. There is the famous Katrin experiment measuring the neutrino mass with a beta decay. And it would be a nice thing to use a microcalorimeter at the end as well after having the filter. This is basically an EMAC filter. You see only the last bit of the endpoint, not as in our case, the whole spectrum. But then you would like to have energy resolution as well. But you're talking about magnetic fields nearby. You're talking about looking into the worm. And we have discussed that several times. There might be solutions, but this is an open question, I would say, at the end.
I have a couple questions about the implanting of the holmium.
Yeah.
With, say, 500 detectors,
yeah.
Do you have a clear picture of how that's
yeah.
going to be done, and to what extent does it have to be how uniform? I'm thinking of yeah. CDMS and how much trouble they had with, had nothing to do with implanting, but about making the uniformity.
Well. I showed this collaboration, and there's a group in Mainz, they work on that. There's a facility which is so-called Risiko facility, where they implant, but also they can co-sputter now material, and they can form the beam in the way we want it for our detector. So we have a certain detector geometry, and they can form the beam in this way. And there's also a mass selection again. I didn't talk about the radioactive cleanness of the material we use. So the point is we have measured the homogeneity over that amount of detector pixels, and it works for that. If you would have a larger number at the time, at one time, you would have to work again on this on the beam, basically. Yeah? But for that beam, it really works. We had done several tests, and for this chip we developed here, this should be not a big problem. So we can then see what the activity in all the pixels is, and we'll determine that. And it doesn't matter whether it's larger or less, because it will just add up in a different way to the spectrum. You have all these spectra you have to add up. It's all you do at the end. Yeah? But it's the problem is here, when you have many, 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 it takes a long time. Alone for ECHO 100K, the estimated time to do this is 1 year, just implanting, one after the other.
The other question I had about the holmium is really about the dysprosium. Hamish Robertson raised this question about the other states
in
dysprosium.
Yes.
Is that a settled issue now? Or
no, it's not a settled issue. These states will be to some extent there, but different calculations show different things, which is an interesting point. We have several theorists in our collaboration, and I mean, all we have seen is that in the endpoint region there is nothing, and there is good reasons for that why there should be nothing, but those calculations are underway, and we will see what happens. That might create a systematic error we cannot eliminate, and then we are done. But that's not yet you cannot conclude this at this point. We are very hopeful that's not the case, but one has to be careful.
Well, with that, I think we should wind up. Thank you.